talking with Dr. Jan Landa, who is a featured speaker here at A4M. So you and I are both OBGYNs, so we deal a lot with women, and women feel that, you know, well, you were just talking with Scott about sex, and so I'm interested to ask you, what is a normal frequency for people to have sex?
The normal frequency to have sex. That's a very tricky question, Dr. Ed. because I don't want to be dodgy about this, but I want to say that I don't think there is a number that I would consider normal. I really don't. I think that needs to be very much negotiated with each couple. I think it's a very individual thing. I mean, if you ask me sort of averages, you know, average is probably just about once a month for many, many couples. When you're having sex about once a week, that's kind of considered to be doing pretty good. And more than once a week is, you know, considered to be great. But that's not taken to be generalized because, quite honestly, you know, there are some people who feel that less than every day is no good at all. And then there are some people who never want to have sex. You know, once a year is good for them. And you know, they hopefully experience other forms of intimacy in their relationship. Mm-hmm. I think the intimacy part is super important. I think that that making sure that you don't lose the intimacy is a really important part of things. And I think that sex many times is part of that intimacy. And I think sex really can help cement the bond between two people. And I think too often we do let it fall too low on the priority list. And I think that sometimes sex can be a very wonderful communication tool between a couple. And but I don't really want to say that there is any norm, so to speak.
Yeah, promiscuity is probably more than I have sex, right? So, but let me ask you, so people with the propagation of pornography, mm-hmm. With these books, 50 Shades of Grey, people's ideas of sexuality have become richer and perhaps a little more polymorphously perverse. So the question is, what is normative in terms of, like, performance? Because a lot of times people will worry about orgasm. Let's mm-hmm. say if you're an anorgasmic or hypoorgasmic mm-hmm. woman, mm-hmm. or even men, as they get older, sometimes the erectile or even the climaxing efficiency can be altered. Mm-hmm. So assuming you, and I know you're an expert with Body Logic MD in hormone rebalancing, mm-hmm. assuming that the hormones are in balance, mm-hmm. how much should people worry about performance? Mm-hmm. Making sure he comes, she comes, we come, mm-hmm. come, you know, all the Latin conjugations, so to speak. Help me out here.
Oh, so you ask really tough questions, Dr. Ed. So what's normal in terms of, or what should we expect in terms of performance? That's yet another question that I'm going to be a little dodgy about, because there really isn't a norm. And in terms of, you know, if you call certain sexual behaviors perverse, you mentioned, you know, I think that we need to be very careful about our characterizations of other people's sexuality, because what's pleasurable for me may not be for the next person, you know, and same with the frequency question, you know. So, but in terms of orgasmic capability and who comes first and when and all of that, I think it's so important not to put that pressure on. I think it's extremely important. I really take a page maybe from the Taoists on that. The Tao talk about that the orgasmic energy is akin to a life force, and they actually recommend to decrease the number of orgasms through life to preserve the life energy. And when I say take a page from that, I don't mean necessarily that I believe that literally, but what I do believe is that, and I think this is very common with women, that for women, orgasm isn't always the end goal of having sex. We can have very pleasurable and satisfactory sex without having an orgasm. I think there's a social pressure that makes us think we need to have an orgasm. Now, I will tell you, I am a 50 Shades of Grey fan. I do like me some Christian Grey, I must admit. But I will say that many women who I've talked about the book with have said, what is with this girl coming every 2 seconds? You know,
right.
that is just unrealistic, you know? And you know, I think that image puts some pressure on us, like, oh, I'm not like that. I don't come as quickly as her. I don't come as often as her. And, you know, I think that gets us into trouble when we try to measure ourselves up against any ideal, especially some theoretically ideal 21-year-old girl, you know?
Well said.
So the end goal isn't always orgasm for women, and nor should it be, in my opinion. I think it's really important to take that pressure off of yourself. You know, orgasms are great, but it's all about the journey, so to speak, not the destination.
Got it.
I think it's really important to make sure that you're enjoying that journey all the way through. And the same for men, to take off that pressure of the end goal of orgasm, you know, and to take that off of, you know, and yet again, I think it comes back to, I think communication is really important there, to communicate with your partner about your wants and your needs and whether the climax is the be all end all or not. And I think that communication can take a lot of that pressure off.
You know, I have an interesting take on the 50 Shades. I couldn't get past a few pages, but I think that as a result of the feminist movement and men becoming more sensitive, let's say, that there's been a crisis of masculine identity. I think that what the 50 Shades alludes to is that women are still attracted to the tall, dark, mysterious, powerful man. Mm-hmm. So I can't help but think in the context of a long-term monogamous relationship, there's so much domestication that... what do you think about the notion that female promiscuity is greater than male promiscuity in terms of libido? Like, men will do it with, you know, other men or holes in the wall or animals. This is probably going to be edited out. But that for a woman, it's very much about the submission and being conquered. Do you think that male sexuality is in a crisis? Like, guys are too sensitive?
That's such a great question about the male identity crisis that really, I do truly believe that guys are caught in a little bit of a double bind situation right now, because on the one hand, they have the women in their lives asking them to please communicate more, please be more sensitive, and yet on some level, we know with the popularity of 50 Shades of Grey, and we know that women on some level want to be protected by this very masculine, powerful role model. And how do men reconcile those two requests from women? Do we even know what we're asking for? And I think we really need to examine this question. I don't have a good answer for this, Dr. Ed. I really don't, but I do really believe that there is a little bit of a crisis that we need to explore for men. I really, and for women too, and for our role in what we're asking for and what we're expecting, and to put forth those expectations to the men in our lives in a way that allows for a consistent message. I think that's a question that women need to really ask themselves and do some soul searching on. What is it exactly that do you want? It's a very tricky, interesting question, and I think for myself, in some of the ways that I consider it more navigable is, you know, when it comes to those sensitive issues and needing to really be heard and talk about your problems and things like that, girlfriends can be a really great outlet for that, because women, we're really wired and programmed for that stuff. And men, I don't think it comes as naturally to them. You know, some of them are really great at learning that behavior. But I think it can take a toll in some ways on men and women's relationships.
Last question, hardest question.
Wow, you've asked some hard ones already.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So, I see in OBGYN that people come in, they're holding hands, they can't have enough of each other, they've been married for 50 years, and they genuinely love each other, there's a compatibility. But, you know, it's probably maybe 1 in 8, and they work for it, and they probably had problems and ups and downs, but it's such a beautiful thing to see. I'm sure you see people who are having sex at 60, 70, because they like each other, they like to have sex.
Yeah.
Now, on the other hand, there are some people who tolerate certain behaviors. You had a great euphemism, I forgot what it was, but have you ever seen, or do you think it's even desirable for a more polyamorous, open relationships? I mean, there's some ancient China, you had wife number 1, 2, and 3, which I think is just 3 times the trouble, you know. There's polygamy in Nigeria. And, you know, certain high-profile couples, they have certain open relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that we're wired for monogamy, or do you think we're wired for polygamy? Which is the, or is it individual?
Wow, you really do like to ask the hard questions. Are we wired for monogamy, polygamy, or individual? Let's see. What would I go with on that one? I would say it's a complicated question. It's a very complicated question.
Do you see people who are successfully navigating open relationships in your practice?
I've seen people in open relationships, and for the most part, I think that some of them think that they're navigating it successfully. But over time, what I tend to see is a deterioration and an erosion of trust. I think some couples even go into it feeling like it's, quote unquote, a team sport, something that they do together, and it's something that they do to increase the adventure in their relationship, and that may work for a period of time. So that may be even something that couples want to experience with to introduce novelty into the relationship, but more often I see it erode the trust. I see it be problematic when maybe one or the other in the couple starts to form some attachment or bond, emotional bond, with somebody outside of the primary relationship, and that can be tricky and problematic, especially, I guess, in a mainly monogamous society. Now, in terms of more polyamorous societies and polygamous societies, there's a different expectation, I would bet. You know, I, having grown up in America and really being much more attuned to American culture than other cultures, I couldn't probably really say, but from what I've studied about it, it seems to me that if you grow up in a polygamous country with very different expectations of, you know, sharing your husband with other wives, and having the support, the emotional support of the other wives. It's a very interesting relationship that forms with these polygamous societies. You know, it's a much more, you know, the way that they raise their children is very different. They do it in kind of a big partnership, many of them. And they, I think some of them view it as sharing of the wifely duties. Like you said, more wives, more trouble. I think some women can tend to think of it as a spreading the trouble around, so to speak, getting some help.
You're funny. Okay, well, thanks a lot.
You're very welcome.
Really good answers.
Thank you.
You handled it like Wonder Woman. Pew, pew.
I think it made you blush at the end there.
Oh, wait. It's just so, there's so many jokes I want to tell, but...
Hey, that was a great tech.
Was that appropriate enough? Yeah, you didn't prepare me.